Today, we are at Expo 2015 in Milan, Italy. The theme of the Expo 2015 is Feeding the Planet and Energy for Life.
The Expo's organisers emphasise that all nations need to envisage sustainable solutions for food security and food safety.
Expo Milano 2015 will be a global neutral platform, an aggregator of ideas, solutions and contributions. It will be the largest worldwide event ever organised on the theme of food around a common goal, assuring safe, healthy and sustainable food for the growing global population.
All World Expo have to decide one topic that is related to something that can gather the world around one important theme that also represents a challenge for humanity in a particular moment of our life. When we started talking of feeding the planet the energy for life, we understood how it could have been related to sustainability on one side and to the customs of the people around the world. And so it brought me a meaning of getting together and understanding together which is the common heritage from a cultural point of view and all the challenges that are related to food nutrition, sustainability, massive production, exploitation of the land. All these kind of topics have different impacts around the world, but commonly attracted the interest of countries all around the world.
Looking at the history of world exhibitions, three eras can be distinguished. The era of industrialization, the era of cultural exchange, and the era of nation branding. Early world exhibitions in the 19th century aimed to showcase national industrial achievements. The first World Expo was held in Hyde Park, London in 1851 under the title Great Exhibition of the Works of Industry of All Nations.
Under the impressions of Second World War and the Cold War, the purpose of the Expo after 1940s changed to the cultural exchange.
For example, 1965 New York World's Fair was titled Peace Through Understanding.
Since the 1980s, the participant countries increasingly use Expo to improve their national images, which called nation branding.
A survey of Expo 2000 in Hanover, Germany showcased that improving national image was the primary goal for 73% of the countries to participate at Expo 2000. Today's world's exhibitions include elements of all three areas. They present new innovations, facilitate cultural exchange, and are used to improve national images. Since 2005, the thematic focus of Expo seems to have shifted to environmental topics. Expo 2005 in Japan was termed Nature's Wisdom, and the Expo in 2008 in Spain was termed Water and Sustainable Development.
The question arises whether this Expo also falls under the main purpose of so-called nation branding, or if it reflects a shift towards a new global scenario that critically addresses the social and environmental impacts of our current food system.
And the problems are serious. Every day, almost 1 billion people go hungry to bed, while 2 billion people are overweight. Furthermore, industrial agriculture is a major contributor to climate change, and the multiple crises of food, energy, finance, and the environment emphasise the problematic trajectory of the current industrialised and fossil fuel-based system of food production and consumption. How do countries, corporations and civil society organisations present at Expo 2015 answer the question of feeding the planet with healthy, safe and sufficient food for everyone in harmony with nature? Which problems are mentioned and which solutions are proposed to the global challenges of food security and sovereignty? In order to find an answer to these questions, we have visited 13 pavilions and conducted semi-structured interviews with pavilion representatives. What is the motivation to participate in Expo? How do they address the main topic of feeding the planet? What is their understanding of sustainability and what happens to the pavilion afterwards?
Follow us to find answers for this question.
The majority of the pavilions at the exhibition are thus government-run country pavilions, which frequently cost over $10 million and represent roughly three quarters of the world's countries. Surprisingly, big transition countries such as India and South Africa are not present at Expo 2015.
From time to time, there are bilateral elements that can impact on participations, but this was not necessarily the case for countries not to come. An Expo is a demanding project, and not always countries are ready to face the challenge of setting up a project management team to develop over the years a project and then to have 6 years of participation.
During our visit to Expo, we visited 10 country pavilions from 4 continents. Angola, Germany, the USA, China, Oman, Czech Republic, Russia, Kazakhstan, and Ecuador. We visited 2 organisations, the United Nations and Slow Food. We also visited the Carp Supermarket. For each pavilion visited, this video will introduce the meaning of the structure, the main message of the exposition, see how the question of feeding the planet is answered, and how sustainability is understood. Slow Food is the only civil society organisation visited which has a big pavilion structure. The Slow Food Pavilion is characterised by 3 open wooden structures which represent typical farmhouses of the region of Lombardy.
We decided to come here with this pavilion, with this shape, because we thought, we talk about food, we are in Lombardia. So these shapes resemble the ancient, the old cascina, which were the farms all around here.
The Slow Food Pavilion is structured in 3 parts: experience and learning about food, a garden and cheese taste area to taste biodiversity.
It's important that Slow Food is here to speak about this team because it's our team.
At the end, everyone. Because you have big companies which now they are leading production in the world and creating problems to the environment. But it's a reality and they are there. And then you have a small-scale farmer, small-scale producer, which actually produce 70% of the world food. And then you have consumers. And as long as you go to supermarket and buy thing, it's political act. It's a political choice. Everything you buy, you can influence the market by your choice. Then you can say that one actor is more important than the other. We communicate the concept of what is biodiversity for us. And we have the exhibition, which is quite interactive. But then we have an area, we have a garden in the middle, so the people can touch biodiversity. So you can touch, you can taste it, because we have the tasting area, and we present only raw milk cheeses. But why? Because raw milk cheese is always related with small-scale production, really, really local. So it's important as a cultural heritage of the place, but even economically, it's important for local communities. We know for sure we are destroying billions of tons of soil every year, and we can't go back. We know for sure that if you keep on pumping the soil with external chemical fertilizer, at the end the soil dies because it doesn't have time to regenerate itself naturally. I think the right way to behave is to consider the global problem, the global issue of food, and not just your local problem. But to take a few steps back on the industrialization, the massive one, everybody knows we waste 40-45% of our food in the Western country, and in the other country they are dying. So if you count the amount of the tons of food produced, and the number of people, it's more than enough for everyone. We don't need to produce more. We need to produce better and to distribute better the thing. So for me, it's sustainable having a lot of different varieties, producing less, but in a balanced way. in a natural, balanced way. So I don't need to put a lot of effort and input in production. So the solution is not giving GMO to poor countries. What to do is, I think people should be more aware of the simple fact that they can do something by the day-by-day choice, at the end can influence everything. These are gonna be divided in modules, like here, after the expo, and they are all gonna be, they're gonna become classroom laboratories in schools in Italy and Africa. So we're gonna reuse it and not throw it away, for sure.
The Slow Food Pavilion provides one of the most holistic answers of feeding the planet. It problematizes the current developments in the global food system on both the production and consumption side. Biodiversity loss, soil erosion, and human health problems are addressed as outcomes of industrialized agriculture, and the low external input of agroecological farming practices are presented as a solution. The expedition area of the United Nations Zero Hunger Challenge is characterized by its emblematic symbol, a blue spoon. The UN contribution to Expo involves different pavilions, and the outdoor exhibitions represent a diverse place all over the Expo.
The main symbol of our participation in the Expo Milano 2015 is the blue spoon. The spoon, because it's the only tool that is used all over the world in the culinary tradition, and blue as the blue of the UN flag. There is a strong synergy between the theme of Expo, Feeding the Planet, Energy for Life, and one of the core missions of the United Nations, which is that of ensuring access to safe and adequate food for all the humankind. In an expo dedicated to food and nutrition, we cannot forget of the people, 800 million people who every night goes to bed hungry. So we want the visitor of Expo to think about this huge number of people suffering from hunger and what can be done to eradicate hunger within our lifetime. One of the main challenges for the future is that of feeding the world population, which by 2050 will reach 9 billion people. At present, we produce enough food for the entire world population. At the present, it's a problem of access to food. In the future, it will be a problem of increasing food production, but in a more sustainable way. This is why we are participating with one vision, that of the Zero Hunger Challenge, and with the theme United for a Sustainable World. So we brought to Expo the call for action launched by Ban Ki-moon in 2012 in Rio+20, because we want to show to visitors that eliminating hunger within our lifetime is possible, and we can reach this goal only if everybody at all levels participate in this challenge. The Zero Hunger Challenge is made of five elements: zero stunted children less than 2 years, 100% access to adequate food all year round, all food systems are sustainable, 100% increase in small order productivity and income, zero food loss and waste. Plus, we added one extra focus area on women's empowerment and gender equality, recognizing the key role that women play in the fight against hunger and malnutrition. This expo is made of, in a way, that everything will be dismantled, but we don't know what is going to happen.
The UN Zero Hunger Challenge was the only contribution which explicitly talked about hunger in the context of the expo. After visiting the UN and Slow Food as organisations at Expo, let's visit the supermarket of the future as a contribution from the corporate sector to Expo 2015.
We are in the supermarket of the future in Expo. It's a thematic area of Expo developed by Coop and by Calorati. Calorati is an Italian architect and is also the director of the Sensible City Lab of MIT in Boston. We developed this concept of supermarket, thinking about the idea of supermarket in 2050. We recollect the idea of, we linked the idea of the Italian traditional market, so we developed a different space, a space more open. We wanted to create a modern store, a modern place with a simple design that can be put the products at the center of the place. The two pillars of this concept are first, a space more open where people can meet other people, where consumer can meet other consumer. And the second pillar is about the transparency, the role of Coop as a cooperative of consumers is to give more information about the product to the consumers, to make possible the choices, the conscious choices of the consumers. For this reason, for example, we insert the data of carbon footprint in each product inside this store of the future. The indicator of carbon footprint contains information about the origin of the ingredients, and the indicator depends also from the process of transformation of the product and the packaging. So we want to insert all type of products inside the store, but give the possibility to the consumer to understand which is the best product considering all aspects, so also the origins and the distance of the product from the local store. This type of apple, the apple origin from Chile. You can find information about the nutritional values and carbon footprint, so you can understand this is a good product which has a low environmental impact, but comes from Chile. So you can choose to buy or not a product comes from Chile. In Italy and in all point of sale in Italy, and also in this point of sale in Expo, we take the product near the expiring date, and we give these products to onlus, to organization that use these products to feed people that needs some food. Our aim is to reduce the waste of food. So we worked with a supplier of packaging to extend the shelf life of this product. And we arrived to develop some solution that can conserve meat and fish until 20 days, meat and fish fresh for 20 days inside the fridge. So we want to help people to reduce the waste also at home, because today a lot of food is wasted at home, at the end of the chain. The supermarket of the future, the concept combines use the technologies to give more information to the consumer to change the habits, or to give the consumer the opportunity to change habits. For example, if you look at the information about the carbon footprint of meat, you can understand the impact of consumer meat. We don't want to put off the supermarket some products. We want to give more information, and the consumer can choose if they want to buy or not this type of product. So consumers' power, I think, can be a right synthesis of this, of our aim.
For the future food supermarket, sustainability can be achieved by increasing product information, which shall lead to more conscious consumer decisions, while continuing to offer both local and global foods. The supermarket of the future puts all burden of change on the consumer, rather than limiting product choice or positioning retailers as agents to change the current food system. Outside the supermarket, the future food district also encompasses a roof garden, an algae farm as future form of human nutrition, and a child learning platform. Most of the country pavilions tried to present their food culture, traditional and culinary arts. The Italian pavilion is the highest at Expo 2015 and designed as permanent building.
The Italian pavilion is the pavilion of the hosting country. The tradition is the biggest pavilion, is one with the highest content. The structure of the pavilion represents a urban forest. You can see from the outside the shape of a forest with having four trees at the four corners of the pavilion. And then one of the meaning of the structure is the connection between the nature and the city. We have a square in the middle of the pavilion. The pavilion is accessible for more than four or five entrances. Square in Italy are a place where people meet, discuss. It's a strong part in our society, and we reproduce a typical Italian square here. Sustainable concrete that we applied in the Italian pavilion is a patent of Ital Cementi, is an innovation project. It's a biodynamic concrete. There is a technical process, but briefly what it does is gets activated with the sun and it collects the pollution and transforms it into inhaled salt, so it actually breathes and cleans the air.
The main message of the Italian exposition is to represent Italy's strength in manual expertise and skills, beautiful landscapes, the ability of food production under challenging circumstances, and the nursery of 21 plants representing the country's region.
The Italy Pavilion, which the main focus is the future, the young generation. Actually, the theme is Vivaium Italia, so we express the strength of Italy, the young ideas that will serve the theme of the Expo. The Tree of Life also is an integral part of the Italian Pavilion. It's not only like a beautiful show at night, but has a strong meaning. The roots of the Tree of Life lie down in the Italian Pavilion, and they collect all the young ideas that are presented inside the Pavilion, and with the gesture they spread it around the whole world. Challenges, in Italy we are one of the most advanced country in terms of like food tradition and also like food innovation. What we see happening in Italy, it's the journey of two like different point of view on food industry and nutrition that they will come together and match. So on one side you have all the traditional slow food and all the typical production of different city, which is one of the best assets of our country. On the other hand, you have the capability of industry of producing with the same quality and the same technique, preserving the biodiversity. So these two paths are going closely together. We also have different representation in the Italian pavilion. So the main challenge will be like to keep preserve the biodiversity and also like use advanced and modern technology also for preserving the environment. And the young generation that are approaching the agriculture, we have this movement of coming back to earth, to working in farms, but not necessarily like it happened in the past, where it goes from father to son, which was like usual. But now we have also this young generation that study at university, they travel around the world, they have most advanced technique, and they apply it to agriculture. They decide to open businesses, preserving the biodiversity, and use different technology, communication, to come out like with a different approach. We have some example in the pavilion of this way of preserving the tradition, but looking at the future and also modernize the process, the idea, and the message that comes with the food.
As host country, the Italian pavilion is characterized by contrasts and tries to increase human awareness by depriving the visitor from things which are taken for granted. Contrary to a purely positive narrative presented in other pavilion exhibitions, the Italian pavilion contrasted nature's beauty with the environmental destruction and problematizes uncontrolled growth. Our next visit is to Angola. The Angolan Pavilion has an open wooden surface structure. Inside, an African baobab tree is modelled, which passes through all floors of the building. The main topic of the Angolan Expo contribution is food and culture, educate to innovate, and displays the country's natural riches and food resources, the empowerment of women and the recognition of their multiple roles in society and the economy in productive and reproductive areas, such as food cultivation, preparation and education, is seen as central. You could get no definitive information on what happens to the pavilion structure after Expo. Even though it is estimated that women cultivate 60-80% of food globally, the Angolan Pavilion was the only one visited which recognised the importance of women explicitly. The US Pavilion is one of the most popular pavilions at Expo 2015. The pavilion structure is characterised by vertical farming. The outer walls are divided by motorised panels which turn towards the sun.
Our architect, James Beaver, out of New York City, designed our building to be an open barn-like structure. So we really wanted to have this similar to what we view America as an open country that is accessible and open to anyone.
The exhibition calls every visitor to take individual responsibility to ensure access to food.
By the year 2050, the world's population is projected to surpass 9 billion people. 9 billion of us. Every one of us deserves the opportunity to put good, safe, and healthy food on our table. This means improving agriculture, promoting healthy eating habits, and combating climate change. Join us in building a world where all 9 billion of us have a chance to thrive.
The theme of the pavilion is American Food 2.0. What is the meaning of this theme?
So it's actually a dual play on American 2.0, American Food 2.0. Most people, especially over here in Europe, think of American food as fast food, as hamburgers or hot dogs or chicken or something that is less healthy, fried, and quick. What we're trying to make the statement here is that American food is actually delicious, world-class, healthy, and a very good, viable option. So on American Food 2.0 is not just the food aspect of things, but actually it's the technology aspect of things.
The pavilion showcases US innovations in agriculture, such as precision farming, cooking, nutrition, industry, and research. The front of vertical farms is harvested every 6 weeks and recycles 70% of the water used for irrigation. The pavilion emphasizes that vertical farms might be a new way to feed the planet.
So this is just showing there's effective ways of using vertical farms and being much more efficient in our water consumption.
We also learned that the US Pavilion is one of the few completely privately funded country pavilions at Expo. After generous public funding during Cold War times, the US Congress passed a law in 1990 restricting the US State Department from providing public funds for World's Fair exhibition.
So three groups really came together to start this. It was the International Culinary Center out of New York City that also have offices in California and down here in Parma in Italy. The James Beard Foundation, based in New York, they're kind of the Academy Awards, if you think of movies, for food in the U.S. So they have Michelin stars in Europe, we have James Beard Awards in the U.S. and the American Chamber of Commerce here in Milan, Italy. So those three groups got together and we put together the bid that we went to the State Department. And this is a USA pavilion, so this is owned and operated by the U.S. government. We're the nonprofit group that came in here, fundraised for the building, designed, programmed, set up everything that's going on. And so we have dozens and dozens of sponsors. Chrysler Fiat's another one. So there are many more of our sponsors here. We try to carefully integrate the messaging that each of these sponsors have about sustainability in their own companies, and we're trying to get those messages out here in the pavilion. We didn't want to be a pavilion that had logos everywhere that was advertising Microsoft or advertising GE. We wanted to, frankly, advertise what those companies are doing about sustainability. And at the end, we'll actually rip it all down and take it apart with our partners and our builders, Neusley Corporation is our builder here, done a wonderful job on the building. So those are the people that are behind this, but it's the state government, the State Department at the US government that approves the programming, approves the messaging that goes in. The whole TTIP program that's going through Europe right now is being looked at, being socialized, being talked about. It comes out a lot in this building. So we have a whole station on policy. It's each one of us has to do a little something more. You look at all the waste that we have on the planet right now, that people go shopping and they buy extra food and it gets thrown away at the end. You get the farmer side of it that they're not sure exactly when the products are ripe. You get the trucking side of it, logistics of trying to get, how do I get the tomato from the farm to the supermarket without it falling off the truck or going bad? There's 30 or 40% waste on either end of this process. If we just eliminate half of that waste, we feed way more people in this place. So that part of this is a huge discussion.
Whereas vertical farming might be an important contribution to feed the planet in the future, we were told that the varieties of vegetables could not be eaten according to Italian law. After asking why, the answer was that the American seeds require pesticides in the Italian climate and are therefore not consumable and need to be thrown away, putting at odds the message it tries to deliver. Based on a Malthusian argument of feeding 9 billion people by 2050, the US Pavilion puts the task of feeding the planet on an individual level. As one of the few Arabic countries represented at Expo, let's visit Amman. At the entrance, there was an installation in the form of a sundial with a number of stones positioned along its surface. In ancient times, this was how the distribution of water was decided in villages. Heritage in harvest, making the most of sea, sun and sand, is the theme of Amman. The central theme is water. There is a section dedicated to an oasis with date palm trees, central to the Omani agricultural tradition, marine environments, and to the hospitality of the people of Oman. The pavilion emphasizes the central role of water to feed the planet and proposes to protect natural resources under shortage conditions with traditional knowledge.
To us, sustainability is something that we know very, very well. Being a nation that produces oil and exports oil to plenty of countries around the world, we do understand that dealing with resources that are finite, you have to be very careful in the way you manage them. As you all know, urbanization is one of the challenges that faces every country around the world. People are leaving traditional jobs such as fishing and farming to more, maybe we could consider them prestigious jobs, white-collar sort of jobs. And this is a challenge, but not to a very difficult extent, because we still have societies in Oman who still live on farming and fishing. The cases that we actually show here in our pavilion is the aquaponics and hydroponics. We are required to return back the land the way we took it. So obviously some elements of the pavilion would be moved back to Oman to commemorate this participation. And unfortunately, some other parts will simply have to be discarded.
Overall, the Oman Pavilion emphasizes its national perspective on water as a scarce resource. We next visited the Czech Pavilion.
Now we are in front of Czech Republic Pavilion, which is very famous among the visitors because of this beautiful pool. What is the connection between this pool and theme of the expo, Feeding the Planet? Let's find out.
At the entrance to the Czech Pavilion, a sculpture in a swimming pool welcomes the visitor. The sculpture, equipped with nanotechnology to purify water, combines a bird with a car with the intention to symbolize the country's ability to combine nature and technology.
The Czech Pavilion, actually, its main theme is water. Water is the energy of life, as we say. And the pool is actually connected to the sculpture that you can see inside it. It's called Heidel Freeform Gate. And it's sponsored by Navigate Corporation, which is the company that is aiming its production on nanotechnologies. And they have innovations in this field, and actually it represents the way we purify water. So there is a connection between the pool and the scientific discoveries we present here in the Czech Pavilion. Our main theme is Laboratory of Life, so we represent mainly the discoveries made by Czech institutions, the Academy of Science, and many other companies that focus on innovations and world patterns that can actually help the world to be a better place and to save the nature, energy, and to purify water mainly. Every 2 weeks there is a different exhibition inside, mainly focused on regions and on the traditions we have in the Czech Republic, to show the world also a part of this compared to the innovations we're bringing. Right now we're standing in the Laboratory of Silence, and it actually shows the typical Czech forest in combination with technology. The mechanism you can see here is connected to a microscopic system, and if you stand right on this spot, the television tells you to be quiet and stand still, and it will take you on the screens. You can then see the projection of the very molecule of the plant.
The Czech Pavilion suggests that technological innovation can be in harmony with nature.
Regarding the food, we actually are the first country which managed to decipher the genetic code of wheat and the banana tree. So this could be very good in countries that are less developed, let's say, or that have less resources and that are more deserted, to grow these plants there. Well, sustainability is something that means that things can be reused or recycled and somehow don't lose their meaning or don't have a lifetime limited. So how we actually consider sustainability is that even this pavilion, which is modular, meaning that it's mantled together from separate modules, will be after Expo removed and moved back to the Czech Republic, where it will become a place for vernissage, together with the company that actually built this pavilion will have its offices in it.
Even though we were first confused about the swimming pool with the combination of a car and a bird, which appeared disconnected from the main topic, Pavilion Press Representative Ava told us that few people came to the Science Week and the majority of visitors indeed seek entertainment. The Russian Pavilion is characterized by a vast terrace which culminates towards the sky with a mirror projected downwards towards the entrance.
If you talk about the structure, the idea of the architect was to give an impression straight away that this is the Russian Pavilion. So basically when you see it entering from the Kumano, you can see the very big building made partially of wood, meaning that having wood, because it represents that we have a lot of wood in the country, we have this vast forest. So, and we use a lot of wood for the architecture as well. It's like, goes way back to the history. So the idea of the concept was immediately to give this feeling that this is the Russian Pavilion, and also to represent the combination of different significant parts of other pavilions of Expo. For example, the roof that goes up like this, it immediately reminds me of the Expo in Montreal. But this was the aim, that it was always so spectacular, you know, the always Russian Pavilion was something to remember from Expo. First of all, the topic of the Russian Pavilion is growing for the world, cultivating for the future. So the idea is to show the potential of the country to feed itself and to feed the whole world, not only now, but also in the future. So of course it's very general, but the idea is we want to show the potential here. Being here, Russia is showing its potential to the rest of the world. And talking about feeding the planet, if you take it literally, you might have noticed that Russia is one of almost a very small amount of pavilions that is actually feeding the visitors. every day, six times per day, we do free degustations in the show kitchen, where we try to show the vast cuisine of Russia. So we do really traditional dishes, and we do it different every day. And in summer, we have 10 times per day the degustations of drinks. So I think this is the beauty of Expo, where each country can actually bring something and share it with the rest of the world.
The Russian exposition showcases Russian contributions to science, cuisine, and food production.
I'm not sure about that, but I think they just bring it down and then use the materials for other stuff.
With a tenth of the planet's arable land and a fifth of its water, the main message of Russia's pavilion is to emphasize its key role in achieving global food security. As a country which is feeding 21% of the world population on 9% of the world's land, we could not miss the Chinese pavilion on our visit. The Chinese pavilion combined traditional and cultural aspects with new technologies. The Chinese pavilion is characterized by a wooden roof structure and flowers at its entrance, reminiscent of the streets of old Beijing. The exhibition is divided in the four parts of sky, man, earth, and harmony in order to represent the close relationship between China's people and nature. In the sky section, 24 phases of the Chinese lunar calendar that regulate agriculture are represented. The largest section devoted to man showcases provincial contributions of silkworm breeding for the production of mulberries or terraced fields for the cultivation of rice as the primary food of the country's population. New technologies related to food, from the Internet of Things to hybrid rice used for 20 years in China, are presented as important contributions to reduce hunger.
这个中国呢，有13亿人口，所以是一个人口大国。那解决中国人吃饭问题是一个很大的这么一个问题。所以中国呢，在这个提高这个农业产量啊，在这个提高农业技术方面，做了很大量的工作。在我们这次中国馆的展示中呢，也有我们这个中国著名的农业科学家袁隆平的一个技术的这个展示。 它呢，大幅度的提高了这个小麦的这个应该是水稻的这个产量，然后呢，解决了中国人吃饭问题。同时呢，我们也把这项技术呢推广到了世界上很多其他国家，也帮助其他国家来提高自己的农业生产。The
land section shows 20,000 LED lights on bamboo sticks as a combination of tradition and modernity. A short movie at the end of the exposition celebrates the Chinese family as a fundamental core of society.
我们在世博会结束之后呢，我们这个中国馆的这个整体建筑呢，将移到这个中国的山东省青岛市，在那儿会有一个这也建一个世博园区，然后中国馆在那里进行整体的这个对外展出。
The Chinese exposition emphasizes the value of a traditionally close relationship between man and nature. Feeding the planet can thus be achieved as a combination of tradition and modern technologies. Our next visit is to the German Pavilion, which took one of the biggest spaces available at Expo, in order to build a pavilion with a terrace, concert area, and restaurant.
It's the same as looking from the airplane down to Earth, to Germany. You have these small fields, and we are inspired by this picture, let's say.
The main message of the German Pavilion is to raise awareness and call the visitor to action.
Our pavilion's name is Fields of Ideas. We would like to show the ideas from Germany which can contribute to the problems or to solve the problems connected to nutrition. And We divide our pavilion in four spaces, which are the basics of the nutrition: water, soil, climate, and biodiversity. So this section is the food section, and then you can get some information which could influence your decision on buying food or do not buy. This is our so-called garden of ideas. So we present here, for example, the topic of guerrilla gardening, digital projects like the website of food sharing. We also show some projects cooking with immigrants and refugees. And the German pavilion doesn't say you have to do just this. Oh, this is the best way. We are presenting several ways, also the very typical or very classical agriculture, but the message is in every field you can find good ideas and good approaches. An expo is a temporary event, definitely. We know after 6 months it's done. Therefore we do not build a pavilion which lasts for the next 100 years.
The German pavilion addresses the main question of feeding the planet by emphasizing the need to preserve and effectively manage natural resources such as water, soil, climate, and biodiversity, and encourages increased awareness on the environmental impact of consumerism. Let's visit a Latin American country, namely Ecuador. The pavilion has a colourful outside, decorated with thousands of shining chains that reflect the traditional colours of Andean craftswomen. The Ecuadorian pavilion showcases the country's unique landscapes and specialty agricultural products like roses and cocoa, which one could also smell. The four geographic and climatic regions of the country, with the export crops of bananas, shrimp and tuna, were presented with a special emphasis on the Galapagos Islands as a UNESCO-protected unique biodiversity habitat. As the first country worldwide, Ecuador included the rights of nature into its constitution in 2008. We could get no definitive information on what happens to the pavilion structure after Expo. The last country pavilion we visit is Kazakhstan, host country of Expo 2017. The Kazakh pavilion is characterized by a metallic structure. The main focus of the pavilion is to attract visitors to Expo 2017 in Kazakhstan. The exposition includes interactive elements and is divided into six areas: agriculture, livestock, Kazakhstan's natural wonders, ecology, aquaculture, and sustainable agriculture. Kazakhstan will host the next expo in 2017 on the topic of future energy. The pavilion addressed both the topic of feeding the planet and advertises Expo 2017 in Kazakhstan. So, did Expo 2015 fulfil the expectations in terms of participation stated at the beginning of the 6-month event in Milan?
We invited all the United Nations countries. So we invited more than 180 countries, and we had a positive feedback from around 140 countries. This is very positive also because we focus not on the number, but on the quality of the presence inside the Expo.
21.5 million visitors and 145 governments, the expectations were met. And how can we assess the Expo's aim of being a policy platform?
The aim of Expo 2015, when it was conceived, was representing a platform where the main discussion around the topic feeding the planet, energy for life, can be run. We succeeded in this, having 140 countries, the engagement of the United Nations and other international organizations. So it's the place where also the most difficult topics can be faced, and even divergent theses can meet a point of confrontation that is open.
Imagine that usually in Italy probably we receive 50 other states. We already almost received 50 other states, And usually it happens in 10, 15 years. We did it in 3 months. So that brings a lot of new discussion.
What happens here at Expo is it's not just the companies that are here that are sharing different Italian companies, US companies, multinational companies throughout Europe, but what also comes in here is the 145 different countries that are here at Expo. Each of those countries are visiting the other countries, so we have delegations in here daily.
So Expo, of course, is a great, great opportunity to bring people together. We do a lot of exchanges. We are friends with many pavilions. We meet them, they come to us. We have a lot of delegations.
You have several levels that cross in the Expo. You have the countries, you have the non-official participants, and the fascination of the Expos is this.
The Charter of Milan is named as the cultural legacy of Expo Milan 2015. Signatories of the Charter emphasize that they recognize the right to food as a human right and they will make informed choices for their food consumption. In conclusion, Expo provides a very diverse image of its main topic, feeding the planet, energy for life. Countries, companies and organizations have addressed the topic in very different ways. Some of the trends which can be spotted at Expo include the increased promotion of online food shopping, reducing food waste, increased food production information for consumers, and a combination of traditional and modern technologies in agriculture. Geared towards consumers of food, the producers of food were almost rendered invisible. Small-scale farmers and peasants, which feed up to 70% of the planet, could hardly be found or represented.
You have the companies, but you don't have the small farmers represented inside the Expo. And it's unfair, because companies, they are reality, but even farmers are a reality. And if it is a world and exposition, you have some of the world represented here, not the entire one.
Government-run country pavilions dominate Expo, which leads to a focus of almost all pavilions on national food culture in a positive narrative. Food pavilions critically address the social and environmental impacts of the global food system explicitly, and nation branding seems to be the main purpose of governments for the costly participation in Expo. The burden of adjustment is predominantly put on individual consumers, thus depoliticizing the food system and its structural inequalities. Even if a shift to environmental and sustainable topics by the Expo organisers can be traced, the World Exhibition seems to remain a forum for nation branding.
Somehow, what I perceive around Expo is like the most important thing is communicate, impress, like a theme park, like Disney World. But the last problem, the least problem is food in the World Food Exhibition. And you can see, because you don't see food, you don't see producer, and the food you can buy average is really low quality. So it seems there is something on the side of the, and which is sad. We are going to have problems, and for we say humans, planet, we are going to have a problem. And in this occasion, you should try to give a solution.
So the answer is the fact that different places have different solutions. So we focused on the answer that can come from small farmers that consider the richness of the land as their own richness and they preserve it, preserving the biodiversity, or the more conscious approach of big multinationals working in a more careful way and finding more influencing, let's say, solutions. It's clear that in 6 months you cannot find all the answers. What you can do is sharing the most relevant results of the debate with the broadest number of people to have the debate grow. And then it's also given, and a part of the event, let some things unsettled, and that can be and that can represent the challenge for the future generations or for the future days. The part of the legacy is also this, being aware that some of the things were not solved or addressed, and keep them and understanding which are the best elements to continue contributing to this.
Our impressions are by necessity selective.
Our journey to Expo 2015 is coming to end. We hope you learned as much as we learned being here. Thanks for being with us.